Now, the concert industry has been plagued by problems. Even if you hate scalping, you've probably bought a scalp ticket without even knowing it. And if you haven't, you've surely been ticketed, you've been ticked that, you know, the Live Nation or Ticketmaster have a stranglehold on ticket sales. So how do fans and bands combat scalpers? We're going to discuss it right now in The Loop. Joining me from Los Angeles to help us make sense of it all, the creator of the Warped Tour, the Taste of Chaos, and the Mayhem Tours, a 25-plus-year veteran of the concert industry, Kevin Lyman is here. How are you, Kevin?
Good, Kevin. How are you?
I'm doing very well, thanks. First of all, congrats. I know Warped Tour is celebrating 15 years, which is just insane. What's going on at this year's show?
This year's show, we're scaling back just a little bit, but we're adding, the bands are going to get to play 40 minutes, and we're leading up to our 15th anniversary show, which we'll be doing in L.A. on September 5th, and that's going to be a Music Cares benefit that's going to be filmed and then shown in movie theaters 5 days later on the 10th of September.
Very nice. Well, Kev, I know this is obviously about scalping and tickets, and I want to get to that, but for years we've heard that, you know, music sales are tanking, it's terrible, bands aren't making money. Are musicians still making decent money off touring? Because I've always heard that if you want to support a band, you go to their show.
I think it is. I think it's, but they're, you know, at every level, I think bands are being forced to be on the road longer and longer. But it's also, how do you monetize that by, you know, it used to be play in a backyard and make $50, and then you'd sell $50 in t-shirts, and then all of a sudden you're trying to sell $50 of your own music. So a lot of these new technologies out there, kids are using, like TuneCore and Audio Life, trying to monetize themselves as they're developing their own businesses because they can't depend on a label all the time to do that for them.
Right, but it's still viable. They could still actually hit the road in the old van, maybe sell some t-shirts and make it happen.
Yeah, but you know, sometimes it's easier to be broke on the road than broke on your mom's couch.
Right. True, true. Ask my mother, she'll tell you. But a recent Wall Street Journal article brought attention to the practice of dynamic pricing, which I hate the term and I hate what it stands for. They claim that bands and their reps are selling the best seats in the house and making as much as $2 million in added revenue. Is this commonplace? Has this been going on for a while?
I think it's been going on for a while now because we were always able to blame Ticketmaster. I mean, you talk to kids on the street, and everyone complains, has a common thing. They blame Ticketmaster. But I think now that the walls are starting to come down and there's more people in the ticketing business, I think people are starting to see that, you know, artists and managers and promoters were all taking a piece of that. So I think blaming Ticketmaster, people got away with it for a long time.
So, I mean, who is the bands themselves? They're given certain seats in the house, right? Like certain bands can get a guaranteed section of seats or rows to sell off. You're saying that they're selling them through Ticketmaster and
yeah, some of the secondary ticket market, you know, StubHubs and some of these things would do that for them. But it's been going on for a long time. I mean, sometimes people get called on it, you know, through the years. But I think now people are really starting to question, how do I get my tickets? I mean, scalpers used to stand in line, and now they have access to the computers. I mean, technology has made it available, and I think there's going to be a little more transparency. I think artists are going to have to take things back into their own control.
But, you know, the fans that point and yell and blame Ticketmaster, don't they sort of have some say to actually do that? Isn't there some clout behind that because of the fact that Ticketmaster has a stake in some of these secondary market sites and they have money to be made off of the scalping practice?
Yes, but I think it's really starting to get back to where people know that the artists really control what they charge for tickets and where a lot of these fees are. Don't get me wrong, I think, you know, someone who sells a ticket should make a living and make some money off
sure.
of it. But these fees can be managed.
Well, you know, Trent Reznor from Nine Inch Nails, he rallied against this recently on his message boards. He said that Ticketmaster themselves could probably end scalping if they just limited the sales per customer and they printed names on the tickets and had a little ID check at their shows. I mean, do you agree with that? Could Ticketmaster effectively end scalping if they did those things?
I think they can. I think a lot of the new technologies, too, with some of the barcoding that'll go directly to your cell phones and some of these new ticketing practices, I think this is a turning point. Now, it's not going to be perfect. It's not going to change overnight. But there's going to be more ways that the person who actually purchases that ticket is going to have more control of what that goes on with that ticket.
Right. And, Kevin, we're totally out of time, but I just got to know, do you see it going that way, or are they just going to move to an auction system so they can make even more money?
I think it's up to the fans to really go to their artists and ask them and demand that they implement some of these practices.
All right, I appreciate that. Kevin, thank you so much for joining us. I really appreciate it. Pleasure to have you in The Loop, sir.
All right, take care.